We hear about be still, be still. We hear a lot about be still. What does be still mean? Does it mean don't move? Maybe that's a start. Don't move. Well, we just said don't move. Okay, and then what? Maybe it means something more than just not moving. Be still. Be still. Be still. What, your mind still? Be still in your reactions. How do we make our mind still? How do we have a still mind? How do we have a still spirit? We can sit still, but our mind is still restless, isn't it? We're still thinking about this, thinking about that, thinking about that. How do you get us, you know, still mind? This is the question. Be still. Be still. I think there's a famous book, Be Still and Know That I Am God. There was a book, a new thought book like that. Be still. So first, when we practice, we certainly are still in the body. We make a commitment that the body's still, and that starts to help out. And so when the mind starts thinking about all this, just doing all this stuff, you say, wait a minute, I'm not doing any of that right now, so let's not think about that. But does it mean to calm our thoughts down, stop our thoughts somehow? Is that what it really is? A lot of people have tried to do that, but have the results really been there? Try to stop our thoughts so our mind is not chattering so much. Is that really the key to stillness? I would submit that it's not. It's not at all. The way to a still mind is to give up judgment. Is to give up judgment. Not day-to-day judgment like walking and driving and stuff like that. That's just locational judgment. We're talking about ideational identity judgment and give up judgment. And so then what is the mind? The mind is no longer engaged in this judgment, in justifying. Give up pretense. Mind's no longer engaged in defending pretense and trying to rationalize it and trying to justify it. And so as we give up these core self-delusions, then the mind is freed up from massive amounts of conflict and effort, and all of that goes with it. And so it's naturally calm, quiet, still. It doesn't mean it's frozen. But it's not conflicted. It's more like a smooth flow, just a smooth flow. I believe this is what's being talked about when we hear, you know, be still, be still, still mind. So it's not something that we can attain. It's not an attainment. Like the mind somehow stops the mind. You know, we're not trying to stop the mind. Okay, not at all, not at all. We're trying to release the mind from its severe preoccupations, unnecessary preoccupations. And that naturally the mind is calm, is peaceful, is untroubled, is undisturbed. Be undisturbed, be absolutely undisturbed is another way of saying be still. So we're certainly getting a new perspective on all of this, which is what we're aiming for. So it's very good that some of this real core misperceptions. The cat decided to climb a tree. Okay. I mean, well, once you go up a tree, then you got to come down, right? So we've been up this tree of spiritual misconceptions. And now we're, you know, sliding down the tree bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. It's not easy to get down off of a tree. I used to climb trees, be a tree climber, and went up to a real tall, real high conifer, you know, and it was awesome. Up above the forest and the wind and the view and everything, was just like, wow, this is so cool. I just stayed up there. And then it slowly started to dawn on me, I need to climb down at some point. And I said, well, I can't do that. I'm too tired. I mean, I said, I think that's the last time I climbed a real high conifer. I think that was it. Somehow I got down, but it was not any fun. So we've climbed this very high tree of self-delusion, really, pretense, and now we're gradually, you know, coming down off of that tree, and we're certainly sure going to be glad when we get to the ground. And that's another good analogy for be still, undisturbed mind. Well, just think, if you're climbing down off a real high tree, you know, just free climbing, and it's like, oh, I don't want to make any mistakes here, and I can't afford even a single mistake. Oh my gosh, how am I gonna? Your mind is really fixated and preoccupied and fearful. But just imagine when you finally get to the ground, you know, all thoughts of how do I get down off of that tree are gone. And you certainly don't want to re-entertain them, and I have not. I never went back to re-entertain any of those fearful thoughts. I said, I'm not going back up the tree, so why should I even think about it? Used to go up to Golden Gate Park in San Francisco and climb trees there. I guess you probably can't do that anymore. There's some pretty awesome trees there, you know. Quite a park. And, well, who knows? There's always tree climbers around. But no, I said, that's enough of tree climbing. And it causes the mind to be quite concerned. And we don't want to go climbing into false ideas, false concepts. I mean, the whole, there's a massive forest of trees of spirituality, you know, and we keep climbing these trees, Maybe this tree is it. Let me climb this tree and get a view up from up there. Oh, it's really cool. I climbed to the top of this tree. I feel very spiritual. And then, how am I going to get down off of this? I can't stay up here forever. This is not going to work out. So it's better to get out of the forest than to keep climbing the trees. We know the direction to how to get out of the forest. You just take that road, take that path, and you're out of the forest. And once you're out of the forest, the whole idea of climbing trees and getting down from climbing trees is gone. And getting out of the forest, it's gone. You don't have to think about how do I get out of the forest anymore. We don't have to. So that's when our mind then can be relaxed and undisturbed and still. Some people have 10 different climbs going on at one time almost, you know. Well, they're climbing one, they're seeing some others that they're going to climb next, so that's the next, after that one's the next, and then they see the ones they climbed before. Yeah, I climbed that one, and I climbed that one, and they're looking for new techniques, and as they're climbing one, they're saying, okay, oh, that tree looks interesting, maybe I should add that to my list, and how am I going to climb that one, you know. So their minds are just like, you know, type A personalities, just go, 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 project, 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 project folder, project folder, project folder. That's not a, you know, quiet mind, still mind. And they think that we all should be that busy too. I don't think so. We don't want that. What happened to the cat? I don't know. Disappeared. Maybe it came down somehow. I didn't hear it. I didn't hear it come down, but maybe it did. Not many people know how to get down out of this tree of spirituality. And when someone does, maybe nobody even knows. Oh no, it is up there. Okay, and now it's trying to come down. It's a smart cat, though. It knows how to get down out of a tree. And we need to be smart, too. We need to know how to get out of that tree that we've climbed of all sorts of various spiritual teachings, which really are not true. Are not true. Wow. I'm just watching the cat come down out of that tree. That's a real pro right there. Real pro. Okay. There you go. Hey, cat. Nice job. Great job. Oh, okay. Its friend just arrived, and it saw that, heard it, and said, "Oh my gosh, that's the one that feeds me," and that's what got it out of the tree in a big hurry. So, just like us, you know, we hear Jesus is coming back. We hear, you know, and isn't that a good motivation to get us out of the tree? That's a great motivation. I kind of feel like I've been trying to get down off of a really high tree and get on the ground, and because I realized, hey, this, you know, there's some great spiritual teachers are coming back, and this is the time. This is apocalypse, tribulation time, end times, and this is when we're promised that we would be helped, and there'd be great opportunity. So better get off of that tree of false beliefs, false spiritual belief. And I can, you know, there's just a massive, a whole forest of it, actually, whole forest full of it. And I've been through that forest, not fun at all. And, you know, everyone you meet has their ideas and the beliefs. And this is how it's been going from time immemorial. And most of them don't have, as yet, have not got it, you know, have not been able to see what's really the case here. Because our continuity fear offers up an entire forest of misdirection. Stuff that looks good, sounds good, think, wow, maybe this is it, and then you end up climbing that tree. You get treed for a lifetime. Many people, you know, life after life after life, they keep getting treed. They climb a tree and they can't get down. I'm too tired, I'm stuck up here, I can't get down, no. So of course, if you tell them, hey, just climb down, no, you're trying to kill me, are you kidding me? It's too dangerous, it's too difficult. But if you got up there, you can get down. May not be that easy. So we're trying to, you know, get down to the ground and get out of the forest. And we're certainly doing this. It has to be in a, you know, pretty timely manner right now. Because the New World Order comes in, they tell everybody, hey everybody, get up in your trees, that's where you live. You live up in the tree, on the top of the tree, that's where you live. Nobody can come down. That's your you know, you're attached to the treetop there. You're human beings, everybody. You're human beings. Imagine a place where it's heresy to suggest that you're a human being. Now that's a nice imagining right there. Flip the whole script of the song Imagine. Imagine there's no place but heaven. You know. Imagine all spirit automatically, naturally in perfect oneness. You know, yeah, flip the entire script, all the lyrics of Imagine by the Beatles. And it's like opposite of that. We have a day left now to the 17th. So everything works, tends to work in synchronicity. There's some great, you know, synchronous, well, the now is always synchronous with itself. How can it not be synchronous? People are saying, yeah, I know Jesus is coming back, but I don't think I'm ready. But for me, I say, I'm ready. I say, happy, come on back. But I'm not scared because I know it's not some judgment that's taking place. He's not coming back for judgment. This is the classic interpretations that somehow the idea is, you know, Son of God's coming back to judge everybody, and then the good ones are going to heaven, the bad ones are going to lake of eternal fire forever and to be annihilated, and you know, the stuff like this. And you know, this is just not the way that it is actually. So there's no reason to fear Jesus coming back at all. No reason to fear it at all. It's all good. It's all good. Compassion for everyone. Just offers a quiet, undisturbed mind, completely undisturbed mind. So that's beneficial for everyone. Now some will get with it more than others and say, yeah, okay. Others will keep trying to earn it. You know, what a mockery of reality to think that we have to earn what God created us as. So we're going slow paced here, letting everything come to us. There's a remnants of a hurricane that's clearing out here that hit Southern California. Some of the remnants hit there and rained a lot. Up here, just a bunch of wind and some clouds, and I think it's clearing up tomorrow. Should be bright and clear. We're going into the mid-September. So most important time in history, mid-September 2015. People are jittery, no doubt about it. Those who believe Jesus is coming back, they know it must be very soon, and they're just wondering, am I going to be saved? Am I going to be saved? Am I going to be saved? And of course, they might want to stay away from Jesus. They wait, I'm not quite. I don't know if I'm going to be saved. If he sees me, he's going to render judgment upon me. Oh no, this is terrible. You know, I don't have that fear. You know, I don't have any fear like that. His judgment doesn't even need judgment. He knows we all have perfect standing. So why should we be afraid of Jesus? He's just here to tell us that we have perfect standing with God. That's all. Why should we run away from that? I would be happy to hear that. Oh, thank you. Tell me again. I have perfect standing with God. Tell me again. Let me hear that again. And let me, Of course, the people got continuity fear say, well, I don't want to leave here yet. And Jesus said, that's okay. God understands that you have a continuity issue here. So Holy Spirit will bless your vision, your perception with vision. And that'll be a nice intermediate step for you. And no trouble. In my experience with Jesus, while the body is asleep, resting, calm mind, untroubled mind. All these troubles of the world do not impact Jesus' mind at all. Untroubled mind. So despite whatever actions Jesus might take, he never loses sight of the truth, which is that we all have perfect standing with God forever, eternally so. So we are, today's the 15th, so we're midway through September. So this is when stuff should start heating up now. So today was kind of a little cool down period for me, catching my breath. I'm actually starting to stretch. I haven't stretched in years. I actually started to did some stretching and some rolling on one of those foam rollers, rolled out my back, nothing cracked, and I said, look, my back's in good shape. Yeah, I was stretching, and I said, well, I'm not in terrible shape, even though I've done nothing so far as exercise for at least a couple years. Nothing but sit. Body seems to be okay. Cardio's probably not good, but so, sort of getting some flexibility, working on some little balance exercises, and starting to get moving here. Mid-September 2015, we are in now. We are in the midst of it. So, it's helpful to at least see someone who's calm about it, and knows about it, but's calm about it, not troubled, but still with a sense of urgency. It's an easy time now to get over-revved, or get overly lazy, one of the two reactions, just like to collapse or to get too amped up. This is, you don't want either one of those. You want to restrain. Oh, well, here's something great that happened today. Quite astonishing. I met someone who works somewhere, and they helped me out in a capacity that they've never done before. It's not even their job to do it. And they were in such a great mood. I said, what's going on? You know, they said, well, I'm leaving for vacation. Friday, I'm leaving for vacation. Or something like, or tomorrow, day after tomorrow, real soon, like in a day's time. They're leaving for quite a long while. Really nice, long vacation. And they're just like, they're in the greatest mood, and all smiling and bubbly, and just because their mind's already on, you know, already on. The vacation is no longer the grind of work, you know, so they ended up helping me out in a way they've never done so before. I was just like, wow, this is like the first time ever. It's amazing. And it just shows you that we don't have to be all downcast and troubled, because we're going to have great good news. Like, our vacation is about ready to arrive, so to speak. Our vacation from the realm of fear, the realm of judgment, the realm of, you know, trying to lose our status, pretending we've lost status, the world of conflict, the world of struggle and strife, and all of the hell that this realm is. You know, we're about ready to go on vacation from that. So we shouldn't be downcast. I know a lot of people, the way things are going right now, the various decisions that have been made, social decisions, and they see the future is just like, just, I don't want to even be here. You know, it's that terrible. But I say to them, hey, that's okay. It just means that Jesus is going to be back very soon. I don't tell them that they're already back, because people might say, huh? But it's a good thing. You know, don't get discouraged by anything right now. Whatever happens, don't even worry about it. It's just, you know, this is the time. And so we're looking forward to the great boost, and we look forward to, regaining our awareness of the one status that we all have. We all have the same status. Which is perfect status. So we're looking forward to regaining that recognition. Now, it's not like the ones that regain awareness of their status, perfect status, kind of leave us unaware of us, because no, we're one family. They're aware of the whole family. So they know that we're playing this silly game and think that we're stuck in it. And they have not abandoned us. I remember Ramana Maharshi, when he's about ready to drop the body, they said, "Oh, this is terrible. You don't leave us." He says, "What do you mean? I'm not going to leave you. How could I leave you? You're one with me. I can't leave you." And where would I go? He said, "Where would I go? I'm everywhere. How can I leave you?" But he said, "Actually, I'll be much more effective not having a body than having a body. I'll actually be more effective." So he certainly said he's not leaving us. So certainly they're aware. Those who have, dropped their, pretensions and accepted the fact that their status and all status of everyone's perfect, they're aware of what's going on here. They know it doesn't affect our status in any way. It's like some kids on the beach building a little sand castle or something to represent their home, and then being terrified as the ocean comes up, the tides come in and out, like, "Oh my God, I'm losing my home. This is so horrible, I'm losing my status." And meanwhile, their true home is completely untouched, completely untouched. It's perfect. These teachers know that the world is going through this situation where we're trying to make, pretension permanent, make it permanent, and as if that's the way to happiness. And they know that's obviously not right. Doesn't work that way. And they know we've been calling out to them, help, for help. And it's just their timing is very interesting, because somehow they don't interfere in a way that makes us feel like they're trying to deprive us of something, because that would cause a reaction from us. It's like they're coaxing us down from the tree, but they don't really climb up the tree and try to pull us down. They say, "Come on down, come on down." So they don't want to scare us, and we're easily spooked, easily spooked to go back up the top of the tree, climb back up again. And certainly, we're close to the ground, and we maybe need a little help at the end there. Like if the branches of a tree are like this, the first branches, sometimes they're high up because they've trimmed the lower ones off and they've gotten old, and they're so. It might be difficult to get from the final branch down to the ground. There might be a little area there where you might need, a little help or something like that. So for some reason, they wait. They wait until it's the right moment. And I feel we're at the right moment. We're getting very much into the right moment now. To start off with, those who are, aware of the situation, and then later on, maybe others will start coming in. Stragglers will straggle in. They'll wander in and say, "Yeah, I think I've had about enough of this whole status, rat race, judgment, all this kind of stuff. It doesn't really seem like that's the answer. Seems like some kind of weird, unnecessary dream," which it is. It's a weird, unnecessary dream. So don't be surprised if something happens in September. Because we certainly have major events taking place in the world. Monumental, pivotal events. And the whole situation is set up now to turn a certain direction in the world. It really is. I mean, when you add it all up, it's easy for someone to proclaim that they, we'll see what Pope and the President, what happens out of that. But it's, you know, easy to see how the Pope could give some sort of credence to the idea that the President is the one that is here to, you know, to save us from save the world from its problems. The Pope might say, this, you know, this man is a genuine leader who's taking the initiative, and we should, you know, back him up. Or vice versa, you know, It could go either way. Or both of them together, that sort of thing. Easy to see that the situation is ripe for this. Very, very, very ripe. Because they've been beating the drums of climate change for so long now that they're telling us if we don't act, you know, in a drastic worldwide way, we're completely doomed. So it's easy to see how something could come out of this. That would be a fundamental paradigm shift in the world. Into a situation where everybody's status is going to be monitored, minutely monitored. And of course, everybody then will be frantically obsessed with their status. And proud, you know, if they're doing what the bureaucracy tells them to do. And the bureaucracy will assign all sorts of categories and numbers. And, you know, it'll just be this massive controls, bureaucratic control system. And people thinking that, you know, this is how we find happiness as human beings and with status. So there'll be a roadmap to status sort of mapped out to human being status. And these two are the ones that have the cachet to declare that we all need to get on this journey together. You know? It's kind of like, okay, everybody, you know, we've decided this is the journey that we need to set out on. And, you know, if the Pope says, you know, well, it's funny. I mean, the non-Catholics seem to follow this Pope more than the Catholics. In fact, there's a lot of Catholics that realize that something isn't right. It's amazing. Our priest gave a homily last Sunday, and again, I'm not Catholic, but I go to church. It's been an education. It's been very interesting. That this Pope is basically come out and said that the way to salvation is through works. I mean, he might add some fluff in there, well, yeah, you need to have faith and blah, 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 but he's very clear about that, you know, get off your rear end, stop theologizing, stop, you know, get out there and do works, 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 works. This is what Jesus wants. So he's absolutely a works Pope, believing in salvation through works. And so the reading was St. James, talking about how that faith without works is dead. Absolutely dead. And then saying that you know, that but works is faith, because it's showing faith through the works, so that works are basically are the way to go. This is what was being said. So I expected the priest to, you know, point out, yeah, you know, works is really important, and don't just, you know, faith that doesn't get the job done and all this. And and of course, faith includes the what faith really is it's willing to believe what the Holy Spirit tells us and what we encounter with in our encounters with truth and God, willing to believe that that is true and this other stuff is not true, actually, even though there seems to be a lot of bogus manufactured evidence to the contrary. So faith really means that, hey, I am perfect. I do have perfect standing. In fact, everyone has perfect standing. I have faith in that. Even though we may not be experiencing it because our continuity fear is distracting us, we still have faith. We know, hey, I'm just being distracted from the truth, but I still believe the truth is true and nothing else is true. That's faith. So of course that's what saves us. We're saved by faith. There's nothing wrong with works as long as we realize that that's not what saves us. It can help. Sure, it can help. But ultimately, what this priest did, I was astonished. He got up there and just gave his homily. And he said, hey, look, they say that faith without works is dead. This is what St. James was saying in the reading. And this is what the Pope is saying. But he said, hey, but works without faith is just as dead. So the whole homily was about how you can't just have works without faith. That's not going to work for you. That doesn't work at all. You have to have faith. You know, otherwise, why Jesus? You know, why listen to Jesus? You have to have faith in what Jesus, you know, what he told us and was pointing to, etc. And I was really, it was amazing. Because this is like completely contrary to what the Pope is really pushing. So, you see how the Catholic Church works? Is bishops have a lot of influence, and the Pope is trying to change that. He's been working very hard to get the bishops in line. Bishops are in touch with their dioceses, and they and the priests know what the bishop, you know, want, you know, the guidelines the bishop gives the priests, understanding of, you know, this is, you know, what we want to emphasize in this diocese. And so that means, it probably means that, the you know, this bishop is saying no to this Pope. I mean, a lot of bishops, I think, are saying that. But that's standard. I mean, there's no one Pope that all the bishops say, oh yeah, this is great. You know, no. I mean, the bishops say, hey, we want to, you know, emphasize what we feel is important here. Because we're also, remember, we're good shepherds. I mean, keep in mind that the original leaders of Christianity were the bishops. It wasn't the Pope. It was the bishops. They called the Pope the Bishop of Rome, but they were bishops in all the metropolitan areas. And they said, look, you know, this is what we want to emphasize. So bishops have always had a lot of influence and autonomy. And so the priest gets up there and absolutely flips the script and says, no, it's the problem we have in the world today, says, is not a lack of works, it's the opposite. He said, there's way too much works and way too little faith. And I said, two thumbs up to that, because that's absolutely true. We are a world right now absolutely obsessed with works. And this is the New World Order. The New World Order wants to get rid of faith altogether. Totally get rid of it and go into works entirely. And you have a Pope who is very much in alignment with that, and a president who's very much in alignment with that also. They both believe that salvation is through works. Now, it's no surprise that the Protestant evangelicals are, you know, one of the main groups opposing this, because of course Martin Luther, the whole Reformation was all about this battle over, was it salvation through grace or faith, grace or works? And Martin Luther said, hey, it's through faith, it's through grace. We're saved through grace, not by our works. And so this has been a big contention between the groups after the schism there. And so, of course, they're going to say, you know, hey, we don't like the New World Order. We don't want to go there. That's not what Jesus told us. Where we, you know, so we are saved by our faith and the grace of God, but not in the way that the Protestants see it necessarily, because they're a little bit off track there. We're saved because we never lost any status. We never sinned. It's impossible to sin against God. They think that we sin terribly, and then Jesus paid a terrible price for our sins, and then the accounts are balanced, as if there's this great legalistic system, God, some sort of legalistic system, which is not true at all. We're saved because we never lost our status at all. No one has. So we can be saved from this false belief. It's a false belief. Jesus came to save us from this false belief. Not by paying some price, but by showing us there's no price to pay. That even when you think you're paying a price, God doesn't even accept that. He says, I don't need you to pay any price. You're perfect just exactly as I created you. And it's impossible for that to be anything else. So how could I create perfection and then demand some ransom price, you know, because you're terrible? I mean, what kind of logic is that? So Jesus came back to tell us the truth, and we have to have faith in this. We're saved by faith even more than grace, because grace implies that there's some deficit or problem we have. We don't have a problem or deficit other than the continuity problem. It's the only problem we have. As I've repeated many times, this is very true. Continuity problem is the only problem we have. We don't have any deficit. We don't have any defect. You know, we haven't sinned against God. We have none of that is true. We don't have any of that. We're absolutely in perfect standing with God, with reality, with ourselves, with all members of the one family. And it can never be otherwise. Impossible for it to be otherwise. So we need faith in this fact as we overcome the continuity fear, because our continuity fear keeps saying, well, wait a minute, you know, what if it wasn't true? And I'm kind of scared, I'm afraid to stop pretending. Even when we know this is true, we're still afraid to stop pretending. And this is our trouble. Now, the grace of God, you would call the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the grace of God. And we experience God's grace through the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit orchestrates this gradual release, evaporation of the continuity fear. This is what the Holy Spirit orchestrates for us. And so we're very grateful, you know, to God for this grace. So you could say that we're saved both by grace and by faith. But really, it's without faith. Well, without either one, you know, it would be too difficult. But certainly, we need some faith that truth is true. And then we need the careful, gradual orchestration from the Holy Spirit to gradually release the fear, you know, more and more release the fear that we have. So, we're saved by faith and by grace, and certainly not by works. However, works can be an expression of faith and grace. It can be an expression of it, okay? But we don't have to express it in any particular format. I mean, we're all expressing something in some way, right? I'm doing my thing taping here. That's works. You know, you could call that works. Sure, I mean, but, you know, usually what we say, well, we have to, you know, works means, you know, feeding people and taking care of their, you know, troubled people, and they look at it that way. But spreading the gospel is works. Spreading the good news is works. Is that not works? But it's faith inspired. See, works that are not faith inspired, that doesn't really get it done. And this is what the priest was saying, that works without faith is dead. So there is not some, like I said, I think that the non-Catholics, non-Christians, you know, may support and like this Pope more than a lot of Catholics do. And that's not a good sign. That's not a good sign, right? Yeah, sure. The Pope might say, "Well, yeah, you need pray the rosary." But what's that? You know, that's goddess worshiping. It's going to the goddess worshiping sort of thing. It's that's not really having faith in what Jesus said. That's just trying to say, you know, keep me doing, help me keep doing good works. Help me keep doing good works. I got to do good works, so just make sure that I keep doing good works, and tell your son, you know, that I'm trying. I'm sure trying with my good works. You know, I know you can pass that message on to him. You know, but I'm too afraid to talk to him because I haven't done enough good works yet, and I've got such a lowly status here, and I'm afraid to be in his presence. So, but you as a mother, you know, understand, you know, what it was like to deal with someone like Jesus. So I'm sure you can, you know, help me out with him. You know, and don't, so that, you know, it's like, this is fearful petitioning. Oh my gosh, you know, keep my faith in works very strong. And they're, you know, they're afraid of Jesus, and this is how the goddess thing works, is when we're afraid of Jesus, automatically we say, oh gosh, I need an excuse. Oh, archetype, or mind imagines an archetype, like of a mother archetype. Say, you know how a kid gets in trouble with a did something bad, and they say, oh, I know I did something bad, my dad's gonna just be so mad at me. And like, hi mom, how are you doing, what can I do for you? You become real nice to the mom, right? You know, as kids, when you knew you did something bad, suddenly, hey mom, can I get you breakfast, can I do this for you, can I take out the trash? And you're like, you know, this perfect little child. And the mother says, oh, what a wonderful child I'm raising, who's doing such good works. Hey mom, can I, you know, go help out, you know, down at the charity thing, and I do this. And all the while the father has not found out what you did, you know. And so you're like terrified that the father's going to find out. And then when the father does find out, you say, mom, I'm such a good little child, right? I don't want to be, why should I be harmed? And the mother says, oh yes, I know, you're the apple of my eye, the pride of my life, love of my life. I'm gonna go talk to the father and ease his judgment upon you. I mean, ease his judgment. So we've anthropomorphized, you know, the deity here by saying, you know, that bring the mother into the situation as if God's some wrathful God. As soon as you make a wrathful God, you bring in the mother worshiping too. Or legalism, extreme legalism. That's another way of going about it. Okay. Which is like, yeah, God, we understand you're like the super wrathful God, but you've given us this grace and all this complex legalistic stuff, and if we do, but so if we, like, if we do this propitiation here, that satisfies this, and, you know, so sacrifice and satisfying all this, that's another way of doing it. So you kind of have this either, like, choice between this extreme legalism, sacrificial, can be worked in there, propitiating, okay, God, I know that you're super mad at me, want me to die, but here, will you accept my goat instead? And God says, wow, okay, but don't do it again. Okay, let me accept the goat instead. That kind of thing. And then legalism is just like so many different laws. You can always weasel your way out of it and say, well, you know, God, I was covered, you know, in this aspect, I was covered by it here because it was this particular day where you allow, you know, a certain a measure of disobedience in any given month, you know, and so I still used up my quota, but I also, you know, gained some, I banked some goodwill by doing this good stuff, and I was good under the law here, so I got banked goodwill by following the law in this case, so the fact I didn't swallow here and deserve punishment, well, I can transfer my, you know, my good, the banked goodwill over to here, and I can cover it that way, you know, so you get all this, you know, business, legalistic, money, banking, ideology of somehow you can weasel your way out of the, you know, the fear of the deity, an angry deity. And then you have the mother worshippers who try to please the mother so that the mother will be so pleased with you that she'll go to the father and say, no, come on. Don't be so harsh in your judgment. Just a little, let me talk with you. And they say, oh, we're safe because mom will take care of dad, you know, for me. this is how it goes. And then you have the belief in like a sacrificial savior, which basically says that all the punishments that that we should suffer. The Savior suffers. The atoning Savior suffers, who suffered all that. So then they know how absolutely painful and terrible the wrath of God is upon us. And therefore now they're on our side because they say, wow, that's just like so hideous. It's not fair. So they can say, hey, God, Jesus could say, hey, God, you know, I've lived with these people. I've broken bread with these people. They're not that bad. They don't really deserve that severe punishment, you know. And so in fact, God, I will actually stay here and live with them. If you want to punish them that bad, I'm gonna stay here. And I'm not gonna go back to heaven. And I'm just gonna stay with these folks until you finally relent. And then the idea is that God will say, oh, okay, wow. All right, I will agree not to punish the people. You know, so they conjure up this one, they dream up this one. So there's all these various techniques to try and avoid, you know, wrathful God, angry God, which is all based on the belief that we have, you know, sinned against God, that we have done something to lower our status, which we haven't. So there is no angry God. So you don't need all these techniques. You don't need these techniques and all the massive belief systems that, you know, are built up around these various techniques, the legalistic one, the sacrificial one, the goddess one, the vicarious atonement one. Those are four of the biggies. And then you have the spiritual one where we say, you know, well, we can attain status. You know, we can get back our lost status. You know, there's that one. We can kill our ego, kill the mind, kill our thoughts. You know, there's that one that, yeah, you know, yeah, there's something that is causing us to lose status, but we can get free of it. So then you have those sort of more approaches that are more spiritualized approaches, as it were, which also are, you know, completely bogus in their premise. So if you let go of all of that stuff, you'd have a pretty still mind, wouldn't you? Yeah. If you were unconcerned with all of that stuff, maybe then you'd just say, you know, you'd be very still. Keep in mind that our fear of God is really our continuity fear. What we really are afraid of is to stop our pretending. So all these different approaches are just delaying tactics. The legalistic one, the sacrificial, the goddess worshiping, the mother worshiping, the vicarious atonement savior one, the spirituality approach, all these things, they're just delaying tactics. That's all they are. And our great fear of ending our pretending, which we're the ones who are angry with God. The whole idea that God's angry with us is just a projection of our own anger to God, because we say, God, you know, you won't relent. You insist that we're still perfect. And if we let go of our pretension, you know, we're going to be annihilated, because we think that is our identity. That is our functioning. So please, God, you know, stop demanding that we are perfect. You know, stop demanding we go back home. And we have this terrible fear and anger, because we think God's trying to pressure us, you know, because the pressure's from within us. And it remains there, and we blame God. We get angry at God for that truth is true. He said, if only it wasn't true, then we wouldn't have to stop pretending, and then our fear would disappear. But so we just project our own anger, fear, and the resulting anger. Those who are fearful are angry. We project it onto God and then think we need to then protect ourselves from God. But what we're really doing is just delaying our release from pretension. We think that God is somehow trying to force us to stop pretending, which is not true. It's not true at all. It's our own desire to stop pretending within us. Because we were created perfect, we're mind idea in the mind of God, and we remain so. And there's nothing we can do about it. So we inherently want to stop pretending. And we feel threatened by that. We don't want to recognize it's coming from us, because that means we could act upon it. So we project it onto God and say, God, you're trying to pressure us. You would stop pressuring us. We're terrified of, you know, our continuity fear is terrible. So what can we do to get you to stop doing that, you know? So we almost have it backwards, really. I mean, the lake of fire, the damnation, is really, that means stop pretending. And it's really the light of heaven that we're scared of. And what we really are trying to, what we're trying to get is make our pretension permanent. So we think if we're just loyal to these delaying tactics, that God will say, oh, okay. Well, our continuity fear will say, you know what? You've been so good at these delaying tactics, I'm going to make them permanent, as if our continuity fear has some power to make pretension permanent. It has no power at all. It cannot do that. So we really have things upside down and backwards, and delaying tactics and all this. But we just talk about this, you know, in a nice, relaxed way, humorous way. Yeah, we start to recognize, hey, that's interesting there, interesting there. Just notice it, I just say, wow, there's a wow right there. Hadn't thought of that before. Yeah, the reason why people are scared of Jesus coming back is they think that Jesus is here to make our pretending permanent. Bring us to some place where we don't feel the pull of reality anymore. They call it heaven, but what they really mean is, you know, that they feel that their mortality and their soul is, you know, somehow that pretension will become permanent. So they're afraid of Jesus because they think they're not ready for Jesus. Why are they never ready? Because within them, they still have this attraction to reality. And they think that they have to get rid of that in order for Jesus to judge that they're worthy to dwell in Jesus' place. So they don't feel worthy yet. They feel that they're going to be judged harshly. They haven't gotten rid of it. And so, of course, they're frightened. Say, well, I'm not quite ready. Yeah, Jesus, I really want you to come back, but not quite ready yet. I still have some sort of bizarre attraction. You know, I haven't got to be able to get rid of it yet. So they have it backwards. They have it backwards. Jesus is looking for those who say, yeah, I have an attraction to reality. That's great. That's what I want. And, you know, help me make it even stronger attraction. But it is characteristic of virtually every one who believes in Jesus is they say, yeah, come on back, come on, please, please, please. But I've never heard a single one say that they're actually ready, you know. No. They say, well, I'm almost ready, but I'm not, you know, I still feel like I'm kind of a sinner here. I'm still attracted to truth. I'm still attracted to the belief I'm perfect. You know, we know that's a terrible sin. That's the sin of arrogance. No, it's not. It's arrogant to believe that we're not perfect. It's arrogant to believe that we can change how God created us. Hello, hummingbird. That is the arrogance, you see? So we're trying to make arrogance true. And we think that Jesus has come back to judge, to look for those who have made arrogance true. Those who say, oh yeah, Jesus, I finally got rid of that crazy belief that somehow I was really perfect. And I know it was terribly arrogant, but I finally managed to eradicate that, or almost, yeah, but I'm sorry, there's still a little bit. I don't quite feel ready yet. Maybe we come back a little later. So the arrogance is to say that we're not perfect, that we don't have perfect standing. That is the arrogance, plain and simple. And then all of the wacky, you know, stuff that defending that, as we've gone over here. And it's not arrogance to set down arrogance, to say, oh, okay, I no longer believe what arrogance is trying to tell me. That's not arrogance. That would be an absurdity. I mean, it's like God created us perfect and only to feel guilty about being perfect. I mean, that's what people are worried about. They say, wow, yeah, but if I'm perfect, I'll feel guilty about being arrogant. I'll feel guilty about being perfect. I can't feel perfect. I can't feel now, the perfection of now. That'd be arrogant. I feel guilty. No, that's not true. God did not create us to feel guilty about that God created us perfect. Thursday the 17th, right? Thursday the 17th. What day is the 23rd? So, 18, 19, 20, 21. It's a Tuesday, isn't it? It's a Tuesday, the 23rd, Tuesday. Today's a Tuesday. That's a week from now. The Pontiff and the POTUS. So we're going over all this stuff right now, and just realize it's possible to get this all clear even while you're here in the world like this. Now you have to be relaxed. You have to be compassionate. Sit still. Be compassionate. Be calm. Be in good humor. And go over this and just take a look at it. And but we can do it. We've done it right now. It's been done right here. All this confusion, you know, looking at it. Just say, okay, just look at it. That's what Jesus, all Jesus asks is just to look at this. That's all. Jesus doesn't say, take action on this. You know, gotta take action. No. We're not. Remember, we're committed to not taking any action, because we are taking action by looking at it. That is the one action that we're taking, and this is the crucial action we need to take. We need to just in a good spirited way, just take a look at it. I won't say it's casual, but I would say, Lighthearted, nice, light-spirited, lighthearted way, with a sense of laughing at our own folly, kind of thing. Willing to look at our folly and try to chuckle about it. It's like, oh, it's exactly reversed. That's pretty funny. Yeah, exactly reversed. Yeah, wow, it's that way. It's funny. See it in that way, not in a recriminating way. Like, oh, well, there you go. I just lost my status. You know, oh my gosh, I didn't realize that I can't lose my status. Oh, I've just lost my status. I just realized I lost it all because I didn't know that I can't lose it. You know, this is obviously a mistake, isn't it? To say that, to realize that we're perfect ruins our perfection is crazy. To say that we tried to deny that we're perfect and that somehow that ruins our perfection is completely nuts. So we have to go about it in this sort of way, very kind, forgiving, compassionate, self-forgiving way. And this is how I experienced Jesus, very calm, not pressing anything too much, you know, just relaxed, smiling, full of good cheer, good spirits, good humor. And we just gently look at this with this good humor, lightly look at it. And say, hey, that's pretty funny. Hey, isn't that odd? Yeah, that's pretty funny. We had it backwards. Wow. Oh my gosh, you know, how funny is that? So Jesus is not coming back to say, okay, have you got rid of that, you know, you got rid of that, you know, that desire, that arrogant belief of yours, you know. No, he's saying, have you looked at the situation? Have you given yourself the time to in a relaxed, non-pressurized way, have you just been willing to just take a look at it? That's all I asked you, just be willing to look at it, you know, just kind of like a cow chews its cud, you know, a cow's kind of contented, relaxed, it's just chewing its cud. We're just like that, we're just chewing the cud here. You know, sometimes we're just quiet, nothing comes to mind, so we just stay relaxed, unworried, unpressured, you know, just trust the Holy Spirit, and gradually the clarity just comes up, we just kind of look at it, and notice it, and say, huh. Okay. That's interesting. Wow. I never saw it that way before. Wow, that's great. I like seeing, looking at it this way. That really explains a lot. So Jesus is just back and saying, has anybody looked at this? You know, I hope some of you looked at this. Anyone looked at this, the arrogance and what it really is and what it's really saying and what it's led you into, the false beliefs. Is anyone able to look at that and not get, you know, not and work through the fear, the continuity fear of it? You know, that's all. That's all. And if you say no, he says, well, okay, that doesn't cause you to lose any standing. You know, you can't lose standing. So maybe it's a good idea. You might want to start looking at it just so you don't keep delaying, you know. Delay, just miserable. You know, delay is just misery. So I'm just, you know, advising, don't, if you want to get out of misery, here's, just take a look at this. Just take a look at it. And of course, when you see it and look at it, it's a wow reaction starts building up. And then you need to be patient with the wow reaction. Because you might say, hey, I can't believe that I actually looked at that. What am I doing? I mean, that cat's out of the bag now. So, cat's out of the bag. I don't think I can put it back in. You know how the cat gets out of the house. One of these skittery cats who wants to go out and play. You know, once it sneaks out of the door, you open the door and it shoots out. And then you realize, oh my gosh, the cat's out. What do I do now? Hey, kitty, 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 kitty. No, it won't come back. It says, oh, I'm out. I'm going to have some fun out here. I'm not coming until I get hungry. So, you know, once we look at this and see it, it's like, wow, I can't really go back to blindly following arrogance. I now see that it's arrogant to say that I'm not perfect. Arrogant to believe that I could lose status. Arrogant to believe that I could gain status. I mean, which is more arrogant, to say I could lose status or gain status? Which is more arrogant? And the answer is that's a wrong question. That's presupposing that they're not equally arrogant. See, which locks us in duality. So we're easily locked into duality by the question of which is more arrogant, saying that I'm, you know, that I could lose status or that I could gain status. Which is more arrogant? Well, that very question is what is arrogant. Let's start with the question first. Instead of, you know, the very premise of the question is that one is more and the other is less arrogant. That's a false premise right there. So our continuity fear is very clever at asking these false questions, because they're saying which is more and which is less. That which is premise is one, you know, one is more and one is less. That's a false premise. They're equally arrogant. There's no difference there. So the continuity fear is always trying to get us to see differences where there aren't any. And then struggle trying to find an answer for false questions, false premised questions. Now, how do I attain salvation? Or, you know, this way or that way, you don't attain salvation. You know, that's the premise, you know, the false premise. We, you know, in other words, we have to somehow get ourselves. Something has to change in us. Something has to, you know, that kind. No, we're already perfect. We already have perfect standing. Nothing needs to be done. Nothing needs to be rearranged. And we're talking about from the standpoint of theory here. Now, from the standpoint of practice, practice might use words like align, 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 align. But we're talking about we're aligning our expectations with to realize that we have perfect status. See, so we're talking about aligning our expectations, which is working with the continuity fear. When you're aware that's what you're doing, then you're not contradicting yourself when you say, well, I don't have to do anything at all. It's not a contradiction, meaning there's nothing I need to change in my being. My being is perfect. I have perfect status standing. But I do have continuity fear, so I do need to practice evaporating that. So, and the problem with continuity fear is it lays out expectations. And when things don't happen according to our expectations, we get frightened. So we keep laying out the future, we keep paving the future in the wrong direction. We keep paving it with our expectations. Our future is always paved with our expectations. And so we have to align our expectations, pave it in the right direction. Pave it in the right direction. And ultimately the paving becomes so beautiful that we realize we don't need to go anywhere. We just look at the pavers. The pavers are so beautiful, we say, I don't even need to go anywhere. I'm just enjoying how beautiful the pavement is. And then you have, at that point, you could say you've reached stillness of mind. Right? Reached stillness of mind. So let's just kind of sit in the wow of that. That where the analogy is, ultimately the Holy Spirit makes our expectations, the pavement, so beautiful, the future so beautiful, that we say, you know, just where I am right now, looking at the future, it's so beautiful, I don't even need to go into the future. I'm satisfied right now with what I'm seeing. And at that point, it's easy then to ultimately set any belief in the future down altogether. So the intermediate step might be said to be a situation, to use an analogy, where wherever you are, what you look out upon is so beautiful that you have no desire or there's no inner compulsion to go anywhere else. See, I feel completely satisfied just looking in my environment that I'm in right now. This is like, it's like perfect. It's just lovely. It's great. I see that I could go somewhere else, but I don't feel any need to. So you feel still where you are. This is what you might call the vision of Christ, vision of oneness. Various terminologies can be used by it. But I believe we're really getting to the truth of the situation here. And, you know, it's right on time. Because again, the 17th is crucial date. Because at that point, it tips closer now to the 23rd, you see. And the pull into the future that has. I mean, it's like two paving crews getting here. The pontiff and the potus getting together, who represent, you know, the two biggest paving crews in the world. And they're saying, okay, how do we want to pave the future, and they're going to come to an agreement. So we both agree that we're going to pave the future this way. So everybody, here's your road, you know, here's where you get to, you know, go along. And what we're saying is that's not the way at all, is that the Holy Spirit will pave our future. Let the Holy Spirit pave our future. And the Holy Spirit will pave it in such a beautiful way right now that we'd say, hey, I don't even need to go down that road. I'm just enjoying looking at the road. It's so beautiful. I feel like I don't need to go anywhere. I'm satisfied just looking at this beautiful road. And this is the intermediate step. And that ultimately then we realize we don't even need a future at all. We just now. You see, just now. So we are getting this grounded here, this clarity grounded now before the 17th, you see? Before most of you may be watching this on the 16th, actually. Let's not struggle with this. Let's just say, wow, this is enough to say, hey, we brought the clarity in. It's here. You know, I don't want to go back over it right now. I'll get confused because it's an effort to get it here. But I know I did. Holy Spirit did through me. So this communication device we call body, a communication device. So it's just now just in the wow. Just rest in the wow. Wow. This is quite a great way to look at it. So right now, we're dealing with the wow, not trying to remember what was said. This is the crucial part of the path. Is once something that is clarified, you know, you get the wow reaction, then you don't try to go back and say, what did I say, what brought it about, you know, what triggered so much clarity? No, the clarity is already here, and it brings the wow with it. So now we just relax in the wow, just say, wow, this is just wow. Not this is great or not great, or, you know, don't try to judge it one way or the other, it's just wow. This is very helpful. So we have the antidote now to what the two paving contractors are going to agree upon. You see, we have an alternative. That's a big wow. Don't try to go back over in your mind right now. Just have faith right now that, hey, it is gettable. We just heard it. It is gettable. This is what's important is to accept it really is gettable. We really can see it. This is a discipline, full stop, and lots of discipline, because the continuity fear, of course, is going to try and get you all confused. So you think, well, maybe I didn't get it right. You know, we got it absolutely right here. There's no question about it. Absolutely nailed it. And the ability to nail it like this comes from realizing that what arrogance really is arrogance is really saying that we're not perfect. That's what arrogance is. So if we confuse that issue, then the continuity fear really will get a hold of us. So I say, absolutely, I nailed it. The Holy Spirit nailed it here, and I passed it on, shared it. Willingness to share with everyone is what I try to do. And so that's not arrogant. It's arrogant to not nail it, you know? It's arrogant to continue to try and go down a pathway of attainment, paving your future with all this expectations of attainment. That's what's arrogant. But we're so used to traveling down the road of expectations into the, you know, into the ever receding future. We're so used to that, that if the road just vanished altogether, you know, we'd freak out. So the Holy Spirit doesn't take the road away from us. It just makes it so beautiful that we say, you know, I'm just happy just sitting here. It's kind of like if you go up to some beautiful lake or see, you know, lake scenery with the mountains in the back, it's just like idyllic, very, and you sit down and like there's a, you know, there's like a boat rental place on the lake that you can start paddling across the lake towards the mountains or get to the other side, and you say, you know what, I don't even feel like doing that. It's so beautiful just where I am. I don't even feel like moving from this spot at all. Don't need to. And then you tend to get very still. The mind gets very still. So the Holy Spirit's right again. It said, don't work on graphics right now. Keep taping. You have to get, you know, certain, you have to share a certain clarity here before the 17th. And that's not some sort of attainment, but it is some sort of sharing. That's a helpful sharing, a pragmatic sharing. You, of course, you could, if you want to engage in wordplay, you could say it's an attainment towards no attainment. But, you know, you don't have to say it that way, you know, because that sort of, then the continuity fear ego, you know, will jump in and say, hey, wait a minute, you know. So, you don't have to, just you know, full stop in the wow is more important. You hear it and then just say, wow. So we beat the two paving contractors to the punch here. We outbid them. We gave a better bid, you know. We said, ah, I've already chosen a contractor. Sorry. When they come knocking, the two paving contractors, maybe I don't know what they'll term. Maybe they'll give some name to them, to themselves. The Pontus. Or the Potiff. Maybe the Potiff. The Potiff and the Pontus. So the Potiff, mixture of Potus and Pontiff, the Potiff, Potiff Incorporated. Potiff Incorporated NWC. Dot. Or Potiff NWC dot Inc. And they'll form a company, a paving company, paver, you know, paving company, and we'll say, oh, you know, yeah, I really liked your bid. Well, I both liked it and didn't like it. I both, you know, accepted it and didn't accept it. And but hey, I got, you know, I listened to another contractor. They gave me even a better bid. Huh? You know, really? Yeah, even better bid. And they said that they can make the road look so beautiful that we don't even feel like going down the road at all. They say, why, but you gotta go down the road. I mean, there's a pot of gold down the rainbow. No, I'm seeing the pot of gold right here. Pot of gold is so beautiful. The rainbow is so beautiful. The pot of gold is so beautiful. It's all so beautiful. I don't feel any need to do anything about it, attaining it. I'm satisfied by the stunning and just incredible beauty of it right here, right now. It's right here, right now, the beauty. I don't have to go anywhere. It's right here, right now. And I think that's a much better offer. They outbid you. Sorry, I both loved your bid and didn't love your bid. I neither accepted it nor rejected it. Sorry, POTIF. So when you're in the wow, you're not allowing any controversy to swirl up in your mind, right? You said, look, you have faith. You say, I know what I just heard. The wow is because of what I just heard. So don't come telling me I'm supposed to reinterpret or confuse. I'm not confused. I'm in the wow of what I just heard. What I heard was crystal clear. There's no doubt about that. So you keep your faith. Faith helps you stay in the wow and not refuse to entertain frivolous quibbling controversy, which is based on level confusion and a bunch of other nonsense. So the wow is coming on really strong right now. It's like a great restaurant. You find out about it, and you might not really realize it at first, but you might go in and say, well, I need to eat here. So, you order like a dessert, and it's like really, really, really good. I did that one time. I ordered this dessert from this restaurant, and that's all I ordered. And it was like unbelievably good. I can't even explain it. It was like some work of art. And then later on, I found out this restaurant is like just awesomely good. All their food is just awesome. And then you go back for more and more, and gradually you find out, hey, everything on the menu is really good. And then you know where to go. But at first it may just start out with just some little thing and just say, hey, that I like that. The path is sort of that way as you, bit by bit by bit by bit, you realize, hey, everything here, everything on the menu is really good. Not many restaurants are like that. It's hard to find a good restaurant, isn't it? The only really good restaurant I know is like 500 miles away from here. So that's it. Yeah, it's really nothing really compares to a really good restaurant. Very few and far between. You have to have everything. Just the ambience, the service, and then breakfast, lunch, and dinner, drinks, and dessert and just the whole thing. And it cannot be pretentious, you know, this is the thing. There's so many places that are so pretentious, so full of themselves, that you feel like that, you know, they're doing you like some sort of honor just to even be there. And I mean, we went to like this one time, got treated to this real fancy high-end French restaurant, super expensive. And it's like the whole time there, it's like, you know, we're just showing you peons what real civilization is like here. And you're paying us a lot for the privilege of this, you know. It was terrible. Absolutely terrible. Never went back. Of course, couldn't afford to anyway. I didn't pay anything. I was treated. But the other places, like, they don't even, you know, they don't brag about it at all. But if you're in the know, you're in the know. So you come in there and sit down and, you know, nobody says, hey, guess what? You just came to the best restaurant in the world and we're going to blow your mind, you know, and you're going to pay us a lot for it. And, no, the food is just, you know, nicely priced. You look and say, oh, it's not, you know, it's not like exorbitant. So we're not in some ritzy, you know, she pretentious place. So the prices are right. You know, everything's just tasteful and right, you know. And then the food comes out and you eat the food and you say, my gosh, you know, it's like the whole experience is like perfect. You know, it's flawless. And then you just walk out of there and they don't say, you know, they don't make you feel like, wow, you know, you're special now because you came here. No, you just, you know, thanks for coming. Wonderful, wonderful serving you. I mean, this is like the, you know, the good service. I mean, they say, hey, folks, you know, it's just been an absolute pleasure being part of your evening. You know, it's been an absolute pleasure being a little part of your evening. I really enjoyed it. And have a great rest of the evening. You know, there's a little, you know, they do a little thing like that, and they're so self-effacing and just saying it's, you know, it's been a delight to have you here. It's really been delightful for us to have you here. They don't say, hey, oh, I hope you come back, and, you know, or they say, hey, you know, if you ever come back, be sure to ask for me, and I'll make an even better experience for you, you know. If there's anything that I could do, you know, make your experience more enjoyable, you know, just be sure to let me know. Yeah. And they'll say, like, you know, hey, is there something, you know, that we didn't have on the menu or anything like that? And you say, well, yeah, actually, you know, what is it? You know, so they'll say, well, this, no problem. I'll tell the chef to make that. Next time you come, I'll have the chef make that for you. No extra charge, nothing. Or they'll, and also, you know, the real good places, you know what they'll do? They'll say, hey, folks, I threw in dessert for free for you today. You guys were such awesome, you know, so awesome to have you here that dessert's on me. It's on me. Don't worry, I got it. The waiter will say, don't worry, I got it covered. I'll cover it. I got the pull to do that. And you guys were so delightful to have you here, you know. I've experienced this, you know, only one time. But really, this is how you wait. This is how a real waiter does it. They don't make you feel like they're doing you a service. They make you feel like you're doing them a service to even show up at their place. Like, it's an honor to have you here. It's like, wow, I'm really honored to have you here. How can I make your experience, you know, meet your expectations here? We're here to meet your expectations, you know, perfectly. Whatever it is, just tell me. Something's not on the menu, I'll have the chef make it. The chef will do whatever I tell him to do. Don't worry about it. I got the pull. So see, the waiter is on your side. You're not worried about the chef. You see, the first thing they do is they put you at ease and say, look, I'm in charge here. I'm the big shot here. Don't you worry about the kitchen. The kitchen does what I tell them to do. That's like the key step. Because, right, like when you go to a really good place, you're worried, like, oh, I don't want to get the chef angry. So immediately they're the great waiters. They run interference for you and say, hey, look, you know, I'll kick the chef out of the kitchen if you know, if I need to. You know, you're the boss here, not the chef, not the kitchen. Kitchen doesn't run things. You run things here. I say, put you at ease. And so by putting you at ease, you know what? The whole experience is it becomes better, right? And the food tastes great, the everything, the ambience, because you're at ease. You're absolutely at ease. So what did I do? Well, I ended up tipping the waiter a ton. I should have tipped him more, really. I should have just given him some exorbitant tip. Of course, I don't have the money for that. But, you know, really. I mean, if I ever met that waiter again, if I was a rich person, I would tip him $1,000 or something, you know. We still talk about that waiter 5-6 years later. All the time. Say, hey, you know, that waiter wasn't like that one. The guy was the best waiter in the world. Because he said, hey. It's like, wow. I can't believe you're here. This is like fantastic. You know, I'm so lucky that I get to wait on you. And you came here to this restaurant where I'm working at. It's awesome. Now listen, you know, I'm the top guy. I'm a top dog here. I got pull. You know, don't worry about the servers, all this kind of stuff. If there's any problem with anybody, you just tell me directly, and I'll just straighten it out for you immediately. You know. Brilliant, brilliant waiter. And of course, we came back again and again, and every time it was better. He's like, say, my favorite clients have come back. This is awesome. I'm gonna get you. Yeah, it's gonna be even better service today. Even better, if you believe me. You know, and I'm so glad you came back. Dessert's on me today, okay, folks. Dessert's on me. Really, seriously, have you ever had a waiter like that? If you ever had a waiter, well, I have. I had the great good fortune of having a waiter like that one time. And it completely changed my expectation, you know, completely changed it. You know, the whole dining out thing completely changed, because now I realize, wow, how terrible most service is, isn't it? It's just awful. Now they come up short so poorly, so bad. And but you realize it is possible, right? You realize it's possible. So Jesus is like this great waiter, you know? It's like, oh, wow, I'm so glad you came to see me. I'm so totally honored, you know. This is how Jesus would be like. It's not all pretentious, like, wow, who are you, you know? Oh, my gosh, this is tremendous that I get to wait on you. And, you know, don't worry, you know, about the kitchen. Don't worry about God. You know, I got it covered. Whatever, you know, whatever you want. Don't worry about it all. And you know, how can I make your, you know, visiting me, you know, enjoyable, and just tell me, you know. And so he's like thrilled, he's overjoyed, you know, that he's here to serve you, the waiter. He's not some pretentious she restaurant that is like looking like who are these idiots that came here to our unbelievably great restaurant? They don't even deserve this good food. No, Jesus will say, wow, you know, I mean, we're gonna do everything possible to like make your meal, you know, just exactly the way you want it. And but we know that, like, you know, it's, you know, it might come up a little short from you, but you know, you just tell us whatever we need to do to make it better. We're gonna do that for you. You know, and if you're happy, you know, we're happy. We're only happy if you're happy. and put you at ease. They're not gonna say, "Hey, we got the best food in the world." You know, they're gonna say, "You know, just we hope you like our food here. We really hope you like our food, and we're gonna do everything we can, you know, to the chefs on board. Like, chef's feeling great today, and he really wants to, you know, he's gonna do a great job making your food any way you want it. Just let us know. If it's not the way you want it, we'll change it for you. We'll get it exactly right for you. The chef's in a great mood today, you know." And if he isn't, I'm in a great mood, so I'm going to make sure the chef does it. And, you know, he can charge it to my account. Don't worry. Don't worry. Don't worry about that. So put you at ease. And then everything seems, their experiencing seems so much better. And we always say, we're going back to that restaurant someday. You know, we're going back to that restaurant. If I should call up the restaurant and find out where that waiter is, they may have moved on by now, you know. But The waiter was like 1,000 times better than any other waiter we've ever had. They're like a member of the family. They talk about, how's your stay here? You know, if you do it, just finding some good things to do. Goes, oh, yeah, that's great. You know, I have a recommendation. If you need any recommendations, you know, just let me know. And, you know, just make you, like, feel like, wow, you're really important. And you're the VIP. And they're just here to try to live up to your, you know, your status, your VIP status. So for Jesus, he, you know, his take is that we're the VIPs. After all, we're the ones with perfect standing with God. Now, he doesn't emphasize his own perfect standing so much, right? Doesn't need to. Because he's here to emphasize our perfect standing with God. So it's like, oh my gosh, you know, I'm so completely graced, you know, that I have these VIPs coming to see me. This is just like, I'm just overjoyed. You know, what can I do, you know, to help, you know, help you, help everything live up to your, you know, perfect status. Yeah. Perfect status. Wow. That's a big job. We gotta be a great waiter for that, right? Now, of course, we're going to the restaurant. We're just these nobodies, you know, from nowhere. You know, no money, nowhere. You just happen to be treated to this. So, but did he look at us and like judge us and say, nah, these people don't have money or whatever? No. He said, here's my two of my favorite people in the world. It was an awesome day for me. My friends just showed up here, my restaurant, at this restaurant. How blessed I am. I'm so blessed that my good friends have showed up here. This is my, wow, what an extraordinary day for me. This is the attitude the waiter had. He's known us our whole lives, but he's dear friends, but he just hasn't seen us in a while. You know, it's been quite a while. It's like, oh my gosh, you know, we got to get reacquainted here, and what, how fortunate I am to be waiting on your table here. And it wasn't pretentious, you know. If he was pretending, he's the best actor in the world. And he was like a super professional waiter, must have been. Or that, or a super great guy, I don't know. But it was like natural, normal, natural. He wasn't putting on an act like get a big tip or anything. No, we didn't feel that way. And even if he was, I mean, he did it so perfectly. You know, we felt like applauding after the meal. You just say, take a bow, you know. I mean, that's just like absolutely flawless. I tell you, that must have got us ready for Jesus, you know, because Jesus is the great waiter. He's here to wait on us. We're not here to wait on him. He's here to wait on us. He said, here come my dear friends. We haven't had a talk in a long time because we've been arrogantly pretending that we somehow lost our status. And here they come, and they're kind of remembering their status. This is like the greatest thing ever, Jesus saying. Ah, this is tremendous. This is my lucky, this is my fortunate day. This is my grace-filled day. Wow. And I get to help them remember what their true status is. I get to wait on them and make them feel like truly, true VIP status, their true VIP status. How fortunate I am today to be able to do that. This is how the gurus think, you know, the saviors, the saints, the saviors, the gurus. This is how they look at it. It's not like you're not a burden for them. I mean, you're blessing them by coming to see them. You're absolutely blessing them. And they're there to shine your shoes, you know? Here, let me take this plate. You know, you finish with your meal. Let me take this plate, and I'll refresh your plate with a new plate. And, hey, let me bring you something, you know. You know, I know you didn't order it, but I'm just going to, let me just comp it for you here. Here, this stuff's really tasty, too. Let me give you a little of this. It's on me. This is the way the waiter was. This is on me. I think you might like this. This is on me. Just give it a try. If you don't like it, that's fine. This is on me. Never had a waiter like that. They obviously believed in their food, didn't they? They completely believed in their food, and they were right to believe in it. This waiter was right to believe in it. Everything we had there was absolutely incredible. So Jesus believes in his food, doesn't he? So he says, let me give this to you. If you don't like it, it's fine. You know, no charge, right? Everything. I believe he believes in his food because the food is the food of God, which is perfection, which is perfect freedom. So he can be this way. He can be so humble because he knows you're going to love the food there. He's not putting on an act. He knows you're going to love the food. So this, you know, it would be very weird to have this great waiter, right, in a place where the food was terrible, right? Because then we think, oh, this is somebody's trying to fool us. But so the great waiter's got to be in a great restaurant, because then you realize, hey, he's not putting on an act. He was telling us true. He was selling us. It was okay. He was selling us, because what he was selling us on was this immaculate food. So Jesus is here to sell us on God, to sell us on our true status. It's perfect. But he's not just, you know, trying to put on an act of selling us that's not true. He's really selling us on something that's great. So, you know, the great waiter fits with the food that's being offered us. So Jesus is the great waiter, and he's working in the perfect restaurant, which is the food of God. What did Jesus say? He who is a servant to all is the one who is truly blessed or saved. The Savior is a servant to all. A waiter. He comes as a waiter. He's there to sell us on the food. Try this out. Try this. You know, otherwise, we wouldn't eat the food. I mean, if we hadn't had a great waiter, we might not have gone back to the place. Because he was such a great waiter, we kept coming back again and again. We tasted the breakfast, the lunch, the dinner, you know, everything on the menu. You know, it was just like, to this day, every day we say we want to eat there. I mean, it was like, you can't beat it. You just can't beat it. And he was part of the equation, too. You know, the service, it caused, you know, helped everything. The ambience. I mean, we walked out saying, we have no desire to ever eat anywhere else at all. Or we'd be happy to eat here every day of our lives, you know, that kind of thing. That's how we felt. And the menu changes.
Yeah. Okay.
And, you know, they have seasonal menus there. So it's always refreshed, always refreshed, always refreshed. It's not like we'd be eating the exact same thing all the time. And if we wanted some variety, we might say to the waiter, hey, you know, do you have any different, compote? You know, maybe make it a little strawberry instead of, you know, pear and kiwi fruit, or, you know, vice versa, or, you know, do you have some, you know, mandarin orange with lime and or whatever. Say, oh, yeah, I'll have the chef make it up. Yeah, that's a good idea. That's a great idea. I'll pass it on to the chef. Yeah, I think the chef loved that. It comes back, you know what, the chef loves that idea. He's going to add that to the menu or something. So they take menu suggestions, you know. Yeah. Raspberry vanilla syrup. Throw a different herb, like the dish. Yeah, it might be. You know, I was thinking maybe you could try this herb, like a little rosemary in the. That would be better. He'd say, "Ah, that sounds great. I get it. Ah, that's brilliant, brilliant." I'll bring it to the chef. Let me bring it back. The chef will have it, you know, done for you. He brings it back, and the chef's done a great job. And you eat it. Oh, man, that's fantastic. And he say, wow, that's great. Now, you don't see the chef, you know, because the chef might be too intimidating. What happened here? Okay, that was just interesting. there you go. We're just flipping the script here is what we're doing. You know, we might be too intimidated by the chef, right? So he says, no. He runs interference. It's just like Jesus runs interference to God. For us, if God came out, you know, we might like, oh, I don't dare ask God, you know, to put some herb in the dish. But with Jesus, it's like, oh, no, I put this, these, don't worry, I'll run interference if there's any trouble. Because we keep thinking there might be some trouble. I don't want to impose upon God at all. Jesus says, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry. The chef and I are best friends. And whatever I ask the chef to do, they're going to do it. Don't worry. The chef is not angry at all. He's very, very wonderful temperament, the chef. And basically, we said, well, prove it. We're kind of nervous about it. Prove it. So if the chef keeps, you know, doing exactly what we ask, then we start thinking, hey, maybe the chef really is nice. And if the waiter tells us, that's for sure, I'm telling you the truth. This chef's the most wonderful person in the world. You know, and then maybe ultimately we meet the chef, you know, way down the road, and we find out the chef is this, you know, blissful, I just love, you know, serving you what you want. This is what I live for. See, but first we're kind of, I don't want to really talk with the chef yet. I want to talk with this waiter. There's a great go-between. So Jesus is like this go-between, you know, with God. But it's always not to placate any wrath at all. It's always in a positive vein. Like, hey, absolutely, there isn't any wrath to deal with at all. We, you know, let us do stuff for you. Give us the opportunity to serve you. You know, give us the opportunity. We're so glad. How was the OJ? You know, fresh, of course, completely fresh squeezed right this moment. They said, yeah, you know, we're getting a batch of OJ in next week I think it's going to be even better. You know, we're looking for a source. We're always looking for sources of even fresher and better tasting. So, you know, when you come on in, I'll give you a glass of it, and you can let me know what you think about it. So they get you on board, like you can come in and taste the food and let them know. Say, hey, you know, just, nah, no charge, just, you know, we value your feedback. And so come on in next week, and we'll serve you a meal of this new source stuff, and give us your, you know, opinion about it. We want your feedback. How about that kind of restaurant, huh? That's what a real restaurant should be like. We so valuable your taste. We so value your taste that come and take this free meal. We know these are our valuable customers. Come in for a free meal. We'll just put on the Ritz for you, and then give us feedback of, you know, what do you think about the freshness of this, the freshness of this, you know, give us your feedback. And so, you know, you come in and you eat and you say, wow, you know, yeah, it really was better. You really hit a home run with the sourcing here. And they say, oh, thanks for the feedback. That's great, because we just, you know, wanted to be sure that you're going to be happy with it going forward. We say, yeah, we're really happy with it. Wonderful, wonderful. What happens? You're there the next night. I mean, you know, right? I mean, just imagine, where do you go find a restaurant like this? But this is just like common sense, isn't it? This is how you should run a restaurant. And of course, the maitre d's there, and of course, they know your name. They're just like, wow, thanks for coming back. Thanks for coming in tonight. This is absolutely great. You know, just I'm really happy that you're here tonight, dining with us, and we're really looking forward to just making this a really wonderful experience. You know, just the kind of experience you like, and you know, however, you know, it's just, we know, you know, it's just kind of relaxed here, and you know what it's about here. So, you know, what kind of seat do you want? Just let us know what kind of seat you want, and we'll get you something that you're comfortable with here. So every restaurant should have extra seating, you know, right? So you feel like you're not being pressured into, oh, well, this is the only seat left, you know, here you go. Nobody likes that. Would you like to dine on the patio? Would you like to dine inside? Would you like to be facing outside, or a wall, or, you know, a seat, or a cushion seating, or, you know, or sofa seating? Or, okay, how about over in this area? You like this? Or there? Okay, great. This is what you like today? Wonderful. Wonderful. They don't just assume where you want to sit. They might say, "What do you want to sit in the usual place, or would you like to try somewhere else?" You know, there's a maitre d', good maitre d', right? That they ease you into the restaurant, and then the waiter says, "Ah, we know who your waiter is. You like, this is their area. Okay, they'll be with you real soon. I'll tell them you're here." So the maitre d' does that. They say, "Hey, I'll tell your waiter right now. Once you're seated, as you're seated and everything's right, they say, okay, I'll tell your waiter right now that you're here. I'm sure he'll be thrilled that you're back, and you know, be right with you." And so they go tell the waiters, hey, you know, your clients are back here, and the waiter then immediately comes up to you and says, folks. Wow, great to see you again. Absolutely wonderful to see you again. He says, I'll tell you what, I've got a couple little things. I'm a kitchen. I'm bringing out to a few other people here, getting them started. And as soon as I do that, I'm going to be right here and get your stuff. Meanwhile, I've got the, I have this other server here who's going to bring you some, you know, water and some drinks, whatever drinks you want, and anything to get you going. I'll have them do that for you. And as soon as I'm finished with these other people here, I'll be right with you like that. And they let you know exactly, you know, what's going on like that. And so you say, oh, okay, great, take that, wonderful, take care of them. And then you just feel relaxed, like, okay, you know, we're in the flow of the situation here. And the waiter explains, yeah, I got some stuff back in the kitchen. You know, some people are ordering up this stuff, and I got that chef's working on that, and I'm working on moving some other stuff out to that table over there. And they let you know that you're part of the whole operation, you know, that you're part of it. And how you affect it all, and then so you kind of feel cool with everybody else in the restaurant too, that they're on board too, and that you're going to get the same consideration also. You know, when somebody else comes in the restaurant, you know, they'll have explained to them what's going on, so they won't feel like they're waiting. How come the waiter's waiting on that table? You know, that's terrible when you come in a restaurant and you're waiting. Somebody else gets some food before you do, and you say, well, I came first, and they get the food first. They're getting, you know, privileged, and I'm not getting it, you know, and you get upset. No, the waiter explains. They might say, hey, okay, so, you know, your dish is going to take about 20 minutes, and there's another dish that our table's having that's real quick cooked. The chef has some already cooked up, so they might get their service first because the chef already had this, you know, cooked up, whereas yours is a special order here, and the chef's really going to put a lot of concentration on making it real fresh for you, so you might have to wait an extra 5 minutes for it. They tell you this up ahead of time, so when somebody else may get something first, you say, oh, that's okay, I know the chef is like putting extra concentration on mine, and it's going to take 5 minutes more. You know, and the waiter might say, hey, you know, let me get you another OJ, you know, free of charge as you're waiting 5 extra minutes. This is how a good restaurant should be run. And of course, you're going to tip these people, you know, sky high. There's no 20% here. It's like whatever you can afford. Because they're making you feel like, hey, you know what, maybe I am perfect, you know. It may remind you, like, the, you know, a good restaurant is like a spiritual experience. It's like, maybe I am important in some way. Yeah, I don't think I am, but maybe God really does love me. You know, I had this great experience here at the restaurant, people treating me like I was important, whereas normally in my life nobody treats me, they don't even know I exist, basically. And these people, they don't ask you what your job is, you know, or what your line of work is or anything, because then that immediately makes you defensive. Like, maybe they'll think that, oh, I'm not that important. What they really say is like, wow, you guys have such good taste to come to this restaurant and come to me as a waiter. I mean, you must have awesome taste. I don't care what your job is, you got great taste. And that's what's really important to us here. I don't care if you're a street sweeper. I mean, you have brilliant taste in restaurants and waiters and food. I mean, you know, you're VIP to us. You know, it's work varies in the world, right? That's not really a measure of a person. It's good taste that's the measure of a person. You know, here they would say this, and obviously you have fabulous taste. So, you know, we're thrilled to have you here. Yeah, they're not concerned about your money, how much money you have. They say, look, you got good taste. Not everybody has a lot of money. We understand that. But, you know, the very fact that you're validating our taste by coming here to us is important for us. It's important that we get validated in our taste by having people like you come to us and validate what we're doing. So thanks for coming here, you know, and thanks for validating what we're doing. This is the attitude of someone who really has something valuable, you know, truly valuable. This is their attitude. Thanks for validating it. Now, I mean, of course, in order to make it all run, you know, they have to charge you something because they have to, you know, they have to pay their suppliers and everything, but you don't feel that's, you know, primary. It's just pragmatic, but what's primary is you're validating what they're doing, validating the place, the decor, the style of waiting, the food, how they present everything, the ambience, the overall experience. You're validating it. For them, it means that they're really in tune with something. They're doing something right. Now, restaurants, some used to be that way. I mean, you know, not anymore, really. I mean, I look for one. Is there any? I give up. What the heck? Why even bother looking? You just, you know, it's like they're there doing you a favor. Like, you know, yeah, I got to work, earn a living. I don't really want to wait on you, but I have to. So, better not make my job difficult for me. I'm miserable enough as is. Got a bunch of other people I gotta wait on too. So, don't bug me. You know, let's just get this over with. It's like a prostitute or something, you know? It's like, so. That's no good. You don't want that kind of experience, right? Maybe not the best example there, really. You know, yeah, it's distasteful. You know, distastefulness. Wish you hadn't come here tonight, you know. Be a lot happier if you hadn't. The food's terrible. By the way, the food's terrible. I know, you're not going to be happy with me anyway. Because even if I give you good service, the food's terrible, and you're not going to, you know, I'm not going to come back to this place, and I'm not happy. So it's pretty tough being a waiter or, you know, in a place that has terrible food. No matter what they're good, they can't make it taste that good. You go home, you got salmonella or food poisoning or something. You know, you're not gonna go back there. You're gonna find something to get angry at the waiter for. You know, how come they? Where's that waiter? You know, where's that waiter? And good waiters, they're always, you know, looking at each table. You know, if they're not doing anything, they have a little break, you know, they're, and even as they're bringing stuff out to one table, I look at the other tables, and, you know, and they're seeing, if you just raise your hand, just like that, and they'll say, oh, and I'll say, yeah, right there, okay. As they're bringing, you know, they're always looking at their entire, you know, table, all the tables, they have to have visual contact with it. As well as they have someone working underneath them that's bringing the dishes and taking stuff off and you know, doing stuff, is also looking at every table. And if they're going back in the kitchen or something, then, you know, the other person's got it, you know, and they go back and tell them right away. So you always feel like you've got communication and contact, and, you know, any request, it's always, you're being listened to immediately. And so you know that these people truly get it. They truly get it. This restaurant truly gets it. This waiter truly gets it. And then, well, you're going to go back to that restaurant for sure. Leaves a lasting impression, whereas the other's just like, I'll forget about that one. Oh, man. And of course, if you have a great restaurant, it makes everything else, like a hotel, wherever you are, it makes it all look great too. Because you see, you know, hey, I know I've got good food. If you know you got this great experience in eating, you know, you relax, your whole being kind of relaxes there. Got it covered. You say, I got it covered. Everything's good. Nothing worse than us worrying about food, right? I don't want to be worrying about food. So that's a vacation. That's a vacation if you get some situation like that. We're just cooling out here. It's great. It's very great. Now we understand the intensity of the times, right? We understand the intensity of the times. And yet we're full of good humor and lightness here and optimism. And saying, yeah, we're seeing the picture. This is how Jesus is. It's like a restaurant, God's restaurant. Jesus is working at God's restaurant. And he's a waiter. He comes up to us, you know, it's like, you know, thank you for coming. Not pretentious, you know, he's not trying to lower himself, you know. He's not putting on some show or anything, but he's just genuine, you know, like genuine, like thrilled that we've come to this restaurant. He says, not money, come to this restaurant, you know. I mean, it's, they think somehow you have to be, you know, like, they haven't attained enough status yet to come to this restaurant. And so what can I do? He said, this is where I work. I wish more came, you know, but I'm thrilled that you're here, you know, thrilled. I'll never stop being thrilled. This is a, you know, this is a memory that'll last forever for me, you know, he's saying it like that. Of course, he doesn't let us know quite that strong, because I'd be like, we come on too strong. It's like, oh my gosh, you know, what is this? It's too intense here. So you have to underplay it a little bit. Have to underplay it. This cat lives in a world of sound and smell. That's just his world. Sound, especially. It's just this huge. It lives in this world just this of these mysterious sounds. There's a sound over there, and I hear his sounds there. It's just like an ocean of sound. This cat just like a fish in an ocean of sound. You know, when the wind's blowing, the cat's like, oh my God, what is all this noise and sound? Oh, this is too much for me. Oh my gosh, I don't know if I want to go outside. What is all this? You know, it's an ocean of sound immersed in it. Now, you know, a waiter working in a restaurant, God's restaurant, he can't leave the restaurant. He can't say, hey, waiter, you know, I want you to do something else. Go out and vacuum the floor out here. Now, well, that's, you know, that's not his job. That's not the waiter's job. The waiter can't leave the restaurant like that. So he can't say, hey, Jesus, you know, I go clean up my yard or something. No, he says, no, my job, I can't leave the restaurant. I'm serving up the food of truth here for you. This is what I do. Hey, Jesus, put a new roof on my house. You know, you're a carpenter. Put a new roof on my house. Well, so I'd love to, but I have to be about my father's business. I work at my father's restaurant, and this is, you know, he's very strict about that as far as, you know, he wants me to be the, you know, waiter in his restaurant, and I have to dedicate my efforts and time, you know, to that. And then you can't say, well, you know, I'll tell you, make a deal. You go put a roof on, I'll come to your restaurant. I said, I'm sorry, I'm not able to make those deals. You know, I just can't do it. But I really, you know, wish that you could come to my restaurant anytime you want. You know, hopefully that, you know, you'll find a way to get the roof on and also find time to come to the restaurant, God's restaurant here. And I'll certainly say prayers, you know, that the grace of God works out so that you can find a way to come here. And of course, when our desire is to go to the restaurant, we find that somehow our life arranged itself so it's possible. Of course, because we're thinking that, well, I need to put a roof on my house so I can seem more important, have more status. The whole point of the restaurant, though, is going there having faith that you do have the status already, no matter what. Otherwise, you'll get caught in the status game. And then you'll see others going to a restaurant who don't seem to have the same good roof that you do, and you say, hey, wait a minute, that's not fair. And then you start getting negative towards the restaurant, you see. So Jesus has to tell us, you know, what the truth of the situation is. Let the waiter be the waiter. You see, if we try to have do something else, then really what we're trying to do, it means we're afraid. We don't want to be reminded of our status. Perfect status. We want to believe that we lost it somehow. We need to gain it back somehow. So we say, well, I don't really want to go to this restaurant. I'm just making an excuse that, oh, I want to, but if you did something for me, then I would. You know, no, those are excuses, delaying tactics. What the waiter would say, well, okay, I'll tell you what. Why don't you just have like one thing? Just order one thing, like a dessert, and see if you like it. And then, just start there. We had some other waiter there when this other, he was off, I guess. And they were very good too. They weren't quite as good, but they were very good too. So all the help there was really good. Somehow they've been trained in genuine hospitality. Old world hospitality. Genuine, you know, the real stuff. First time in my life I've ever experienced that. Only time, actually. Only time experience genuine hospitality. That wasn't based on who you were status-wise in the world. It was based on the fact that you're here now. That's all that matters. Fact that you're here now is all that matters. Doesn't matter where you're going after here. None of that matters. You're here now. I am here now. I am the now. They realize, Jesus knows that, you know, I am the now. We are the now. So the now is treating the now. knowing this, you know, there's nowhere else to go, really. It's kind of like we're at a table and we're sleeping, and then we wake up and there's the waiter said, "Ah, welcome to the restaurant." Then we eat some food, and then we fall back asleep. You know, dreaming that we're not in the restaurant of now, the now restaurant. Naukani, the Naukani restaurant, or something like that. And then we wake up again. Then the waiter says, "Ah, wonderful, you've come to my rest. Come to our restaurant again. Wonderful, great." They don't say, "Hey, you just fell asleep." You know, not, they don't. They don't say, "Oh, you came again to the restaurant." You say, "Oh yeah, I guess I did." And then they serve you again. Then you fall asleep again, and you know, they just let you sleep until you wake up again. "Oh, I came back again. Wonderful, great to see you." And then gradually you start thinking, "Wait a minute, what's going on here?" Then you might say, "Hey, did I just kind of snooze?" And they said, "Yeah, it might have been it. I might have had a little snooze," which is great. It's a wonderful place for a snooze too, right? And that it's great that the food was so good. You thought you could have a little snooze. It's wonderful. And I say, "Well, maybe you did. Maybe you snoozed and maybe you didn't. Or sure, yeah, you snoozed and you both snoozed and did not snooze actually." I say, "Oh, thanks. Yeah. You both snoozed and did not snooze." That would be the right answer to say. "Did I fall asleep in your restaurant?" "Well, you both fell asleep and did not fall asleep in the restaurant." "Oh, thanks. Wow. See, now we're really getting to it. This is how the good waiter would say it. You neither snoozed nor didn't snooze. "You neither snoozed nor did you not snooze." "Well, yeah, no, you neither snoozed nor didn't snooze." "Or, yeah, you both snoozed and didn't snooze." "Or you both didn't snooze and did snooze." And you say, "Ah, thanks, okay." Then you start thinking about it. I think I might pay attention to this and see if I snooze or not, you know. And then you fall asleep again and wake up again. "Hey, did I just fall off again?" "Well, you both nodded off and did not nod off. You neither nodded off nor not nodded off." "Oh, thanks. So this is the way that you handle, you know, your creativity, your continuity fear. Because you don't want to say, "Oh yeah, you fell asleep in the restaurant." Because you're saying, "Well, you both fell asleep, but also your dream was also beautiful and creative. And so it really wasn't, you know, really sleep. It was just that you were decided you wanted to dream for a while. So how else could you dream for a while if you didn't fall asleep?" And so we honor your dreaming, you know, just as if you were also not dreaming. So yeah, you both fell asleep and didn't fall asleep. So then you get this feel like you're being honored, even though you fell asleep, you're still being honored, you see? So this gives you, then you're able to say, "Oh yeah, okay, maybe I don't want to fall asleep anymore here. There's such a great place. They even honor me when I fall asleep." And they'll say, "Well, you know, we can't feed you food when you're asleep. You know, it's not possible, but that's great. I mean, you both fell asleep and didn't fall asleep. That's how we look at it." And you say, "Wow, I really like this restaurant. I'm going to make a big effort to stay awake here." How are we doing here on time? Okay, it's kicking off at like 2:27:17 or something like that. I don't know why. It's inscrutable, this program. And sometimes it goes off about after an hour. It goes, you know, air. Unsupportable air. Unknowable air. Unfathomable air here. Now it takes a real pro to be a great waiter like that. Because they don't miss on anything. They know the whole thing. From start to finish, how it goes. They don't miss a beat. Like a great drummer in a band, you know. I mean, they just don't miss a beat. They don't miss anything, do they? They just lay down that beat, and it's just like, wow, how do they do that? It's really something. Great drummers. There's a bunch of them. Everybody has, you know, who's a good drummer, I don't know. Some people say, you know, Ginger Baker. You mean going way back, you know, Ginger. Somebody says, Keith Moon, who, you know, beat the... Charlie Watts, who's a good drummer. But then they get in, you know, there's all these fancier drum kits, you know. Who's that guy? Can't remember his name. I know Van Halen, Eddie Van Halen's brother, for Van Halen, drummer Van Halen, using the double bass drums. Some say that he's pretty good. I like the drummer for Blondie. He's really, really good. Awesome. He can like make the drums the main instrument in the song and not even hardly notice it or bother where he's like. What's that song, Dreamin' by Blondie? I think that's the song that the drums are just like. He went on to play for a lot of different groups or something. I can't remember his name. But yeah, they make the song. You know, some drummers can just make the song somehow. And then you get Hal Blaine for the Wrecking Crew, of course, the studio musician. Hal Blaine played on more hits and songs than anybody in history, like over 10,000 or something. You know, they're just like flawless. Then you get all the jazz drummers and stuff. I don't you know, listen to a lot of that. I haven't listened to a lot of it. I've heard it, but I don't. You know, didn't spend a lot of time listening to some of those jazz drummers. And tend to be more creative. But a great drummer, you feel like you don't have to worry. They're in control of the song. You can't lose. You can't screw it up. There's no way. I'm going to play from the first beat to the last beat and just nail it. So you just, I mean, everybody else, you know, you just do your thing. You know, I got this song absolutely already completely done. It's already done. That's what you want. I mean, if you want a band, you need a drummer that just says, you know, I've got this thing absolutely already done. It's already done perfectly. Because no matter what you're doing, the beat goes on, right? The whole song's going on. All the acts, everything is there. All the accents, you just do your thing and you know it's going to sound great. So then you relax and you do really good too. If you worry about the drummer, then, you know, you got troubles. That's why great drummers are in such demand. They're in such demand. Everybody wants Ringo Starr for the Beatles. It was very solid. Not spectacular, but, you know, he knew that he was going to. I mean, they got rid of the previous drummer. Was it Pete Best or something? No, who was it? Was that it right? Maybe it was Pete Best or whatever, but they got rid of the original drummer because he wasn't good enough. They got Ringo Starr. They all relaxed. They said, you know, we can record with this guy. We don't have to worry. We can just focus on what we're doing. Okay, we're almost done here. Yep. So Jesus is like this great drummer, you know, just this great drummer. He says, don't worry. Yeah, you come in the band, say, oh, I got to play in your band. Oh my gosh. He says, hey, don't worry. Listen to this. I can just nail it. I already got the song. It's already done. And you know, how'd it turn out? Fabulous. Even before he even played the song, he says, oh, it's already done. It turned out absolutely perfect. Absolutely perfect. And you say, okay. Okay, great. Yeah, I could relax here. And then you end up, you know, playing, you know, way better than you thought you would, actually. And then he said, see, I told you. Didn't miss a beat. We didn't miss a beat, did we? And, of course, a good drummer could cover up for all mistakes. You know, if you somehow trying to get out of tempo or this or that, but keeps the tempo going, you know, but anything that isn't right, the drummer can just do it. Boom, boom, you know, right back in it. You like that. Like, oh, that was planned. It was all planned. That was planned. That screw-up was actually, it wasn't a screw-up. It was, you just threw a little accent in there. I threw a little dash of something in there, you know, just to make sure the audience paying attention. Is that you guys paying attention? You were paying attention? Great. You know, and just wake, you know, wake you up, make sure you're not going to sleep there. You thought we were slipping, huh? Now we weren't slipping. It just gave me an opportunity to do a little flourish there, you know. They were just making sure that, you know, threw me a bone, just, you know, make sure, give the drummer something to be a little creative with, you know. And so the drummer just smoothed everything out, Everything smoothed out, keeps it all smooth. You can do no wrong. And then maybe you get a little tired, you know, the drummer just like, say, you know, and then the drummer's going to do a solo here. And you just, you know, yeah, take a break, you know, relax a little while. And the drummer, you can hold the audience for however long you want, you know. Just going along, you know, and just, yeah, we're just riding along here in the car, you know. Whoa, hey, look at that place. Just riding along in a car, just enjoying it here. We're all enjoying it here. We're gonna come up some really nice scenery up here, folks. I'm gonna, you know, let you know how the scenery sounds. You know, he's like, oh, okay, yeah, it was nice. You know, just, don't worry, I got a million more. And the audience says, oh, great. You know, this is fun. And now we bring back the band members. All right, yeah, everybody's in a good mood. This is what a good drummer does. That's why oftentimes the concert starts out with the drummer, right? You know, and everyone starts going, all right, you know, and you hear the drums first, and then out come the, you know, out come the other musicians, like, oh yeah, introducing here. And they put their, you know, instruments on. Meanwhile, the drummer's just laying down the beat, you know, getting everybody ready. Drummer's all important. I remember we had a band, we didn't have a good drummer. We finally got a really good drummer, but he was too good for it. We weren't good enough for him. That's the problem. It didn't last, but he went on to play with a bunch of other groups. It was in demand, very much in demand. Good drummers are very much in demand, you know. The people go to them and say, hey, come over, play for us. We'll pay you a lot more. How's they paying you? We'll pay you a lot more. We've got better gigs, you know, better this and this and that. Drummer says, huh, you know.